it's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will.
Well, Ronnie, good morning. Guess you know I'm not going to let this go. I can't let it go. And we can't let it go until there is a reasonable explanation as to why a four-month-old was killed. And we owe it to him, his baby boy. It was not as a result of his efforts that he is dead. Now the coroner has announced that that child was shot once. Multiple shots into his father. We understand now that a Gulfport policeman, a deputy of the Harrison County Sheriff's Department, and several state troopers, highway patrolmen, are now on administrative leave or on desk duty, pending the investigation done by the Biloxi PD. And it's being done by the Biloxi PD primarily because there were no officers from the Biloxi PD involved in the shooting. In other words, when a department is involved with shooting, then it can investigate itself. That's what that's all about. So, for me, it's all about the four-month-old. Say what you will or may, it boils down to whether or not the police took the consideration of that four-year-old in, well, took the four-year-old in consideration.
Month.
Oh, I said four-year-old. Pardon me. Four-month-old. This is a baby in arms. Still no information as to where the baby was. There is no doubt that law enforcement believed that the baby was on board. The Be On The Lookout For indicated that Smith had his four-month-old son in the car. Just looking at the things we know, there are some determinations we can make. There are some of you who don't want to do that. It's your prerogative. I believe my eyes. If some of you feel just by second guessing or asking the question of law enforcement that somehow or another that is not supportive of law enforcement, I will bring you back to Derek Chauvin, where about 17 officers testified against this criminal who was wearing a uniform that day. I can give you a whole long list of officers in these United States who are currently incarcerated, because they stopped acting like an officer and started acting like a criminal. You may not like hearing it, but it doesn't mean it's any less true. There's something that eggs me. There's something that just I can't get out of my head. And it is this four-month-old. After over 20, Roe counted at least close to 30, 34 shots. After the exclamation of the passerby, you heard this, the scream of that four-month-old. You play it again. You hear it very faint in the back. Play it again. That's not the same one. I want you to enhance that more. Yeah, I hear it. Now, what does that tell me? That tells me that baby was alive after those shots were fired. There's some other things, ladies and gentlemen. Do you realize not one shot was fired on that 130-mile so-called chase? At law enforcement. and law enforcement was within, in some cases, 20 feet. Law enforcement was literally passed by on the interstate from Pakistan all the way to Biloxi, mile 40. In other words, they had blocked that cordon off that Smith could see as he was traveling with flat tires, ultimately coming to four flat tires, slowing him down to a crawl. If he can get and make 20 miles an hour, he was lucky. He knew that there was nowhere to, no down ramps. There's no doubt in my mind that this person obviously was not in his right state of mind. There's no doubt in my mind that, okay, had that Smith, who was a suspect in the alleged murder of his girlfriend and her nephew, there's no doubt in my mind that he had some things going on in his head. He wasn't right in the head here. Remorseful? You could say. Angry? But let me just tell you what he wasn't. For 130 miles, he was not deadly against law enforcement. He wasn't shooting at law enforcement. Even after the spin-out maneuver was done with Smith, the deputy jumped out of the car. You'll see it there in the video. Not only did he jump out of the car, another patrolman ran around the front of the car. Clearly on the tape, you can see this. The dog ran around the damn car. No shots. No shots, Chief. Does that sound like someone who is right now? Sound like someone right now that you need to be real scared of? Or does it sound like someone who is just trying to figure out what the hell he's going to do now? Got my baby? Should I do suicide by cop? Should I shoot my baby? Because if I can't have it, nobody's going to have it. I'm just going through this, as horrible as it might sound. What is obvious here is that the target was not law enforcement here, ladies and gentlemen. We're not talking about some heart-throbbing chase down the I-10, 130 miles an hour here in Gulfport, Mississippi, Long Beach. No, 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 no. You're talking about something else. We're talking about a father who, as well as a result of a domestic dispute, feels that he is going to not let anybody take his baby from him. That's what he feels. And don't get me wrong, he probably could very well have loved a mama one way or the other. Unfortunately, sometimes the only rage that a man shows is toward those he loves. Nikki Giovanni said that. Horrible thing, but sometimes that's what happens. We owe this four-month-old an explanation for why he died. Now, if you want to say it's because of his father had him in the car, you can take the easy way out. You can take that route. Well, had the baby not been in the car, then he wouldn't be dead. Really? So that baby was in the car from Baton Rouge all the way to Biloxi, Mississippi. And so it was only as a result of crossing into Biloxi, Mississippi that the baby had to die. Do you know what the Baton Rouge police chief said? He said their first priority was to see to it that the child is safe. That's why, ladies and gentlemen, Smith was allowed to leave Baton Rouge. That's why they, even though there was some chase, there was, okay, look, there's a baby in the car. We can't make the capture of this guy more important than the baby in the car. No, I'm not going to let this go. And I'm not going to let Breonna Taylor go either. These are just American citizens. Innocent American citizens shot down, and there has to be both consequence and an explanation. And ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to tell you, I don't doubt that every officer involved, I would hope every officer involved, is going through some kind of remorse. And you should. Even those officers who didn't fire a shot. We actually did still frames on what we have seen on several videos, by the way, to try to isolate which officers did the shooting. One of the officers that had a long gun looked like an AR-15. Was the officer that could have been the canine officer. He's the one that grabbed the dog. Now, I don't know if he was the canine officer or not because the dog was running around. And he was within close proximity. Some suggested that he did the shot. We couldn't really see the smoke coming from the muzzle of the firearms. But we were just kind of trying to isolate who and what. There was an African-American highway patrolman with a large fellow there in the frame that upon shots being fired, took cover behind the vehicle, as any reasonable thinking person would do. We did not, however, see any puff of smoke coming from that vehicle outside of the windshield being shattered. We stopped it to see, well, okay, what was it that Smith was sticking out of the top? When you look at it and you pull it up close, you will see at the top of the door. You can see some object at the top of the door. Now, why? At the top of the door? I don't know. Was the window up? So the coroner, I understand, wrote, you followed up on this, so there is no report as we normally would get on both the autopsy of Smith and the child, except to say that the...
Yeah, not as of yet. They're releasing, of course, statements about what was found, but the ballistics are still pending, so the official coroner's report is still also pending. But like you said earlier, we do know for sure, according to the coroner, and the autopsies, that the child died of the single gunshot wound and the father of multiple, but still no word on where that gunshot wound came from, definitively that killed LaMello.
And Coroner Brian Switzer said, although there was one gunshot wound to the child, it is unclear where that gunshot came from. Let me see the hands of those who right now have a tendency to not believe what you're hearing from law enforcement. It's okay. I know you support law enforcement, but no, really, this is important for those law enforcement who's listening to Rip Daniels. You know, there are many who feel, let's see the hands of those who feel that Chief Miller, he's an honorable, respectable chief. There's no doubt about that. I have found the guy to be very, very honorable. See the hands of those who feel the chief would just assume not tell the truth for the sake of trying to, you know, not cause the angst for law enforcement, even though it's not one of his guys. I see your hand. See the hands of those individuals who feel that that even the coroner would not be honest. Now, I'm asking this question for a very good reason, and this is something that, rather than being critical, I know you're going to have some individuals out there, oh, you got to be critical. There you go again. You're putting on the police. It is important for we, the American public, those individuals that you seek to protect and serve, have the capability of believing you beyond the appearance of impropriety. In other words, the appearance of impropriety is enough to cause doubt by we, John Q. Public. You know, just how it looks, bro. Look at there. Here's a man with a baby in a car. It appears he's not going anywhere. And there's at least 30, 40 officers around him. It appears that there was something improper done. See, the appearance of impropriety, ladies and gentlemen, is what sows the seeds of doubt. And it was a time not long ago in my country, ladies and gentlemen, that the appearance of impropriety was enough to get supervisors kicked out of office, judges off the bench, policemen off the force. They may not have done anything wrong, but the appearance that you did something wrong. Because what it does is it creates an environment in the public that leaves a blemish on the agency you represent. It makes us kind of go, you getting away with that? Yeah, I don't look right. I don't know about government. It is the appearance of impropriety, ladies and gentlemen, that at one time in my country, circumstantial evidence, some might call it, some might call it innuendo. Some might call it suggestions of something being done wrong. You know, when there's a reason for sunshine laws, which basically says, you've got to do everything in the light of day. In other words, you've got to publish agencies that have to publish, government agencies have to publish when they're going to have meetings and so forth. Because of the appearance of impropriety, bro. It appears if you do not let the public know that you're going to be meeting and they are invited, then it appears that you're doing something wrong. Just that appearance can result in a fine for those of us who serve on commissions and boards. Literally. And suspensions. And even investigation by ethics or peers or whoever. The appearance of impropriety. There's an appearance of impropriety here. There's something improper. It's done. We've not heard from the chief with the exception of the press release that was sent out. That's it. You did, in fact, talk with the public relations.
Public Information Officer Major Christoback from Biloxi indicated that they are still doing the investigation and are holding off on statements until it's concluded.
And Gulfport?
I had the opportunity to speak with Detective Ducre. He indicated, he confirmed that the one officer who was involved with the shooting was placed on non-enforcement duty per their policy. And it is still an active investigation.
We owe an explanation for why this 4-month-old was killed. That cry that rang out over the sirens was screeching for me. It just, folks, that was screeching for me. I don't know how anyone cannot hear that and say to themselves, hey, they sat on a car that had a baby in it? Well, they were in fear of their lives. Is that what you call being the champion, being the... So in other words, you would not put your life, you wouldn't risk your life to save a 4-month-old? I want someone to call me and make that argument again as what someone did yesterday. Well, they were in fear of their lives. What are you going to do? It was either them or the 4-month-old. Damn. Whatever happened to women and children first? What's wrong with we who are call ourselves men? What, you bunch of wusses? I don't think that. I think this was an utter and complete disregard for these human lives. They didn't matter. That baby boy didn't matter. Parker did not matter. I'm not letting it go, Chief. I want you to know that. And we shouldn't let it go. You don't have to go national news. You don't have to go marching down the street, hands up, don't shoot, all that old bull. Nah, that's up to you if you want to do it, but I ain't doing it. If I march down the street, I'm going to be very well armed. I can tell you that right now. because I never can tell. You never can tell when such time that there's an individual who is in fear of their lives, and I don't know it. Safer for me to assume that, okay, I've got some nitwit out here with a gun who doesn't know when to use it, or at the very least is negrophobic, and so subsequently, he now, under the color of law, can say, oh, yeah, well, there's Rip. He's got a gun. Now, enough's enough. If a four-month-old child is not safe from law enforcement, I didn't say from some deranged Caucasian father, because that happens all the time. And if anybody doubts that, just tell you what you do. Just pull up the morbidity report of Caucasian kids, and then you'll understand what I'm saying to you. No one molests and kills Caucasian kids like Caucasian daddies and adults. Oh, but that's no major news. We don't profile them. You know, Margaret Baker in the Sun Herald did a piece to evaluate when the use of force is necessary. Very good piece. If you do not get the Sun Herald, I suggest you do so. I don't mind telling you that. You can get it online or otherwise. It's a local paper. You can't wake up every morning and think you're going to find out what is happening around you by just simply going on Facebook. And that's why so many young people are in the dark now.
What happened? I don't know.
But thank goodness you listened to me. But I'm taking it one step further. We can't do all the research, and there are some individuals who I respect as journalists and who will do the heavy lifting. Margaret Baker's one of them. So the question was asked, at what point can law enforcement use lethal force? And this is a very cognitive piece. I think they did an excellent job of going through when asking the question. Policies don't lay out specific circumstances or criteria for using deadly force. They require officers to protect human life, but they don't tell officers not to use deadly force against a dangerous suspect when doing so could also harm innocent parties. Third parties. This is what it says, quoting Margaret. Human life is sacred, reads a line from the Bay St. Louis Police Department's use of force. Protecting human life is the most important mission of our agency. Well, human life, is that a four-month-old or is it the old guy with the gun sitting there with a Kevlar vest who can hide behind his car at any given time? Here's what policies say about deadly force. Mississippi Gulf Coast law enforcement. Officers shall never use deadly force except to protect his life or the life of another human being. That needs to be changed. It didn't used to be that way either, by the way. I'm going to tell you, this has only been in recent history that you actually saw it protect his life. Oh, I know what you're going to say. Well, come on, they want to go home to their family. Well, hell, everybody wants to go home to their family. But it used to not be like that. Look, this is recent that you have to protect his life and the life of other human beings. It used to be to defend life. His life was not put at the first. Right now, it's like, I ain't going to do nothing that's going to hurt me. Yeah, that's a noble position to take. I'm not going to risk my life to save others. What a knight you are. Deadly force is authorized by a police officer only to achieve the following lawful objectives. To defend himself or others against serious threats of serious bodily injury or death. To stop dangerous felony flight where there is serious imminent risk to the public or death or serious bodily injury. Now, I want you to apply this to this situation. Man, in a car, stuck in the grass, officers all around him, literally. Here's the Biloxi Police authorized deadly force. I want to see Gulfport. So Gulfport, really? Gulfport cited exemptions to Mississippi records laws and refused to share their use of force. Chief Riles, why? It's just the use of force. Reach out to Ducray and ask him if he would forward that over. Maybe they just didn't like the Sun Herald. We're friends of theirs. I mean, just given the why they use the force, I don't see the sheriffs in here either. and reach out to Sheriff Peterson as well. I know that two of their officers are implicated, but still, just getting the use of force. Here is what, let's see, let's go to Biloxi's use of force. You know what it is? To defend themselves. Again, the guy who we set out to be our champions and defenders, first and foremost, got to defend myself. Look, folks, I know. Rip Daniels is talking off his rocker there. Yeah, well, you know, you got to defend himself. But ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to tell you, true heroes always put themselves last. I know some. That doesn't mean that you go in stupidly, but when you have the equipment and the training and you know good and well that it's a possibility it can go very, very bad for you, you've got to look at that innocent individual and say, look, am I going to let this four-year-old get killed? Am I going to risk this? Because his daddy's shooting at me? I can't do that. So Biloxi is to defend themselves or others against serious threats of serious bodily injury or death. Number two, to stop dangerous felony flight where there is serious imminent risk to the public or death or serious bodily injury. Number three, to prevent roaming at large by obviously mad or vicious animals. To leave animals so badly injured that it cannot reasonably survive. Number four, to stop imminent damage to or theft of property. How about that? I didn't know that one. Which by its removal or damage seriously threatens the life and safety of others. Oh, okay, now I see. So it's not about stopping a burglary. It's about someone snatching someone's oxygen who's dependent upon oxygen. I got that. You got that?
Got it.
Imminent damage or theft of the property. In other words, go in and you destroy someone's IV, knowing that that person can ultimately die as a result of not having an IV. So I want you to apply this, you, my audience. I want you to apply this and give me the scenarios in which you think, these officers there on Tuesday should have been authorized to use deadly force. Let's just say, give a hypothetical here. If a gunshot came from Smith, who hasn't fired since Baton Rouge, officers in close proximity. He hasn't fired. Okay, that's not to say that he can't fire. So you hear a gunshot. Is that enough? Imminent threat? Danger to himself or others? You got to tell me. I mean, in other words, there were some officers who were standing out there like, I don't know, John Wayne? Well, you don't, John Wayne's too gone. Who would stand out? Thor? What about Thor? Captain America, yeah. Without a shield, but got all, you know, the other body armor. Standing out there as if to say, okay, well, he didn't seem like he was too damn scared.
White Captain America, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Was that a black one?
Yeah, now.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
So it's integrated now.
Yeah, I guess.
So is Captain America, is he ethnically,
Oh, he's a brother.
Oh, yeah.
He's from NOLA.
Dark-skinned brother.
Yeah.
Okay. Just want to make sure. Dark-skinned don't nearly get the kind of play they need to get.
True.
Always that ethically vague thing.
That's right.
High yellow boys.
Well, yeah.
Not like me, but more like you.
Okay. All right, Blondie.
Really don't, folks. You need to insist upon it, too, by the way.
Right.
Need to be no doubt whatsoever. So here you have, by the way, the African-American highway patrolman ducked behind the car. You see the hands of those who feel that that was appropriate or that was scared. Yeah, right. That was smart. So, bro, let's apply this now. So, let's just say that, that Smith shot. Is that reasonable enough in your mind to fit any one of these criteria?
Not in my mind. It really, well, a shot will be construed as a threat. just based on the wording of that and having gone over use of force policies in the past, any even threatening movement, like even raising the gun to fire, is going to be used as an excuse or as a viable threat, depending on what's happening. If there's a crowd, if there are other people, so I have no doubt that that was possibly a catalyst. Even if he didn't raise a gun out of the window, even if it just looked like a gun might have been coming out of the window, you know.
All right, I want you to pull this up, and you, my audience, I want you to do the same. I want you to pull this up now. Because what this says is the lawful use of force. And these are the rules. I laid out the criteria, starting first with Bay St. Louis and kind of in Biloxi. What is left out of this, ladies and gentlemen, here's what's left out of this, and what you are going to hear before this show is over. When shouldn't an officer use lethal force? I know, it says, well, the only way you use lethal force is to defend themselves and then to defend others. The connotation behind this, the antonym behind this, the opposite of this, is never use force when it comes down to presenting the injury of others. You got to understand this. That was a two-month-old child. Do police officers use its weapons when such time it could result in the death of others who are not a suspect, in the death of individuals who are innocent, death of individuals who are just passersby? In other words, police is fired upon, broad daylight, in a mall. By the way, this happened in front of the Empire State Building. And the police did not fare very well. Can police officers then just arbitrarily begin to shoot? And of course, there in front of that Empire State Building in New York, at least four people were shot by law enforcement. Oops, my bad. Most of the officers did not fire. The one officer who did fire was held accountable. Because the converse of what you just heard regarding lethal force when defending themselves or others, who takes precedent, themselves or others? Simple question. You answer it first. Then I'll give you the policy when I come back.
Get the info.
Stay informed. It's a new day with Rip Daniels, the number one talk show in South Mississippi on Jay-Z 94.5.
Just like a bird, I just want to fly free.
So high.
And I own a piece of land. Somewhere. In a country.
Listen. A coward dies a thousand deaths. A soldier dies but once.
Temperatures like 100 degrees. Like I got chains in me. Blackmail in the family of three. Been proud of my destiny. Reckon I'll fly away. Cause it's too much for the man. Shouldn't have gone down this way. What happened to my master plan? Cause I can't figure out. I could have been a love child. Shouldn't have gone down this way. Tell me, how did I get lost?
A coward dies a thousand deaths. A soldier dies but once. A coward dies a thousand deaths. A soldier dies but once.
Michael, police say baby LaMello Parker was a casualty of his father's actions, but providing little else about how that little boy died at the end of a violent police chase.
They are lighting this Eyewitnesses capturing the moment a violent day came to a deadly end. Eric Smith, dead after a gunfight with law enforcement. His four-month-old, held helpless during his father's run from the law, also shot. The baby, LaMello Parker, rushed to a hospital. Doctors trying to save the child, but couldn't. The baby boy died Tuesday morning. Hours earlier, the child's mother was murdered. Her nephew also killed.
I went in the room and tried to pick her up to see if I could help make a tourniquet on her or something, but she was lifeless and there's too much blood coming out of her head, you know.
Eric Smith killing his ex, his child's mother, Kristen Parker, and Brandon Parker inside their home on Richmond Drive in Baker. Today, children's shoes still strewn across the front steps. Neighbors won't forget the chaos.
Say it ain't so, you know. Maybe it's a mistake, you know. Why, you know, just why, you know.
This man, who did not want to be identified, says his kids are good friends with Kristen Parker's four other kids.
They want to know why as well, you know, and I don't have an answer.
No answers, but a startling memory of the one time he had a run-in with the man who caused so much grief on this block, Eric Smith, the killer.
I saw him 2 weeks ago. I was cutting the grass. Come over here and cut the grass, and I was on my lawnmower, and he pulled up, and I mean, I just got a strange vibe. I just got a vibe like, you know, make sure he's just the lawman type, you know, type vibe. Like, it was just a jealousy type. I just got a bad, bad vibe from it.
A feeling that wasn't far off.
That's the news story coming out of Baton Rouge.
That's WBRZ, Channel 2 News, Bess Casserly reporting, and I take exception to a lot of that report.
Why?
Well, the report started with, you know, the indication that the father is wholly responsible for the child's death. Now, it's no doubt that the father had the child on the high-speed chase against law enforcement. Duh, we know that. But to immediately place the blame directly in the lap of the father, pun intended, is a disservice to that child. Secondly, she indicted this man for the killing of his child's mother and her nephew with absolutely no evidence, because I spoke to the coroner's office this morning and ballistics are not back yet. So he's the alleged killer of his child's mother and her nephew, unless there's some information that Baton Rouge have that we don't, but I doubt it.
Very poor reporting, no doubt about that. For her to refer to him as the killer really is just very, very poor. Don't get me wrong. He's a suspect, no doubt. But that's not the way you report this now. I have no empathy or sympathy for anyone who would take the life of anybody, including a four-month-old. By the way, Kristen does have four other children. And, of course, little LaMello was her youngest at 4 months old. No history of Smith outside of the fact that he had one situation involving domestic violence and another in 2017 where it was a misdemeanor, simple battery. He punched his boss. However, there was no cause of domestic disturbances there at that address up until Monday. For those of you who are trying to come up with some kind of vilification, my primary concern is the four-month-old, the innocent here, folks. That's my concern. And there has to be an explanation for why little LaMello had died. And it has to be someone has to take responsibility for shooting little LaMello. like it or not. And who law enforcement, be it the Sheriff's Department, Gulfport PD, or Highway Patrol, they represent us. We are society. We are society. And we bear a responsibility whenever they do anything. And I take that personal, particularly when it comes down to a four-month-old here, folks. All right, 228-896-9455. You know, if the Baton Rouge Sheriff Department says, Sheriff Sid Goche, if he would say that their top priority was locating and keeping the child safe, then it should be across the dadgum board, bro. Hearing that child scream after those shots, and then the straggler shots, what was that all about?
Was it
two or three that happened, I mean, within several nanoseconds after everyone ceased fire? What? Did you still see movement, or are you just taking pot shots and shooting at the car?
Yeah. And there's no explanation. But you can hear them plainly after the initial volley has ended.
Oh, Johnny!
I'm still hearing 5-6 shots. And you can visibly see the car. Any movement in there, anybody? If I missed something, please let me know. We've been enhancing this thing. We're just not seeing it. And then you hear the baby cry. All right, 228-896-9455. Who was it, Mr. Jones? Did I miss him? Yeah, give us a call back. Some of you folks who have been waiting in line, I appreciate it, but... got to get it off my chest first, and then I'll allow you to do the same. Let's get Ronnie in. Ronnie, good morning. Thank you for being patient. I think yours was very clear yesterday regarding this being a hostage situation. And I want you to know, Ro is going to reveal what happens, what is the procedure in a hostage situation, and when should an officer not use lethal force. So you'll hear that shortly. What's on your mind, Ronnie?
Mr. Real. I got a couple more questions to ask you.
Yes, sir.
Now, that baby's family need to get a lawyer so they can do an independent investigation so we can get a clear picture of, one, if, take for instance, the car itself, the car. If there's no powder burns or powder residue, not burn, but if there's no powder residue in the car, that means that the it wasn't a gun fired in the car. Is that not true?
Well, I'm no ballistics expert, but I don't doubt that could be the case, unless he actually had the gun outside the car, stuck his arm outside the car, and then fired. In such a way,
okay.
Depending on the wind, because, you know, if you fire it outside the car, his hand sticking out of the car door, possibly, I mean, I'm no ballistic expert, but if you do find powder in there, then you and I both would agree that more than likely, he fired a weapon. Does that matter?
Okay. Okay, wait a minute, Mr. Real. Okay, so, independent investigation, I remember they did that with this one case, to where, you know, the lady shot the guy saying that he was reaching in the car for a gun, and they showed where the window was rolled up, so it was impossible for him to be reaching in the car for a gun.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay.
The independent investigation was, you know, see, they're going to take the police cam video, they're going to take the car cam video. And it's supposed to be able to show if he put a gun outside the car to shoot at police.
But my question to you again is, does that matter?
What matters is that if he didn't shoot at the police and he didn't pull a gun outside the car pointed at the police, then the police life wasn't in danger.
Does that matter?
You got to.
Again, my question for you. I hear all of that, and you're playing lawyer, you're playing prosecutor. The question is still, even if he did, is police authorized to use lethal force when innocent life is at risk?
What matters is that you shot up a car when you could have used another line of being able to apprehend the suspect.
Hold on, Ronnie. We'll be back.
Get the info. Get the info.
Stay informed. It's a new day with Rip Daniels, the number one talk show in South Mississippi on Jay-Z 94.5.
You know, at the time this song came out, ladies and gentlemen, Americans had a reasonable expectation that all would be well. What happened?
What would you do if I sang out of tune?
Would you stand up and walk out?
Would you stand up and walk out on?
Yeah, lend me a ear.
Lend me your ears and I'll sing you a song. I will try not to sing out of key.
All I need.
Oh, baby, I need
a little help. Just need a little help. All right, folks, good morning to you. Rip Daniels here. Thank you for joining us. The show is called It's a New Day. There's only one rule. There's no such thing as a right or wrong opinion here, folks. And I'm not going to let it go. Until there's a reasonable explanation, we've reached out. Right now, Biloxi PD is finding out or doing the investigation to determine what happened that resulted in LaMello being killed. Who killed him? And why did officers fire a barrage of bullets into a car that was not fleeing, sitting there like a duck? And so, yeah, 228-896-9455. And it has not hit national, but I don't doubt that it will. I will tell you this, that it is something that has raised the concern of the FBI. I can tell you that right now. Let's go to back to Ronnie here, and I see you, Mr. Jones. We'll get to you. Ronnie, appreciate you waiting through the break.
Yeah, Mr. Rip, the reason why I say why I ask him questions is because I want everybody that shot in that car to be fired. That's the first thing. And whoever bullet, if they found retrieved the bullet that shot that baby, I think he need to be brought up on charges. Manslaughter charges, because you could have easily, like I said yesterday, you could have easily surrounded that car, and you could have called a hostage negotiator and got that baby out that car safely.
You may not know exactly whether or not Smith would have allowed that, but let's just explore what you're saying. In St. Louis, in the Breonna case, you remember when the attorney general, wearing a handkerchief on his head, came out and indicated that the only charge was going to be against the officer who put the neighbor at risk for firing wild...
I remember that.
You remember that? The officers who actually shot Breonna were not charged. You know why that officer was fired and in fact held responsible for being negligent? You know why?
No, tell me, Mr. Rip.
Well, very simple. He put an innocent life at risk. You must know your target. You must not sacrifice another life, because then you become the threat. You understand what I'm saying to you? That's the reason.
I heard that exactly.
The question would be, well, if they knew that child was on board, which they did.
Right.
Does that not say, is that not the same thing? Negligence in firing and not having a target and not putting someone else's life at risk?
I agree, Mr. Rip, and that's why I say everybody needs to be fired. And the man who fired the bullet that hit the child need to be brought up on manslaughter charges, if not murder, second-degree murder. because, like I said, you didn't have to shoot in that car with that baby, because unless we see where this man shot at the police, you shot prematurely at a target and killed an innocent life. It ain't no ifs, ands, and buts about it, Mr. Rip.
The difference is whether he shot or not. Whether he shot or not, you do understand that they were not at liberty to shoot. We'll be back.
WJZD FM Long Beach, D. Iberville, Pascagoula, Biloxi, the all new JZ 94.5.
Hey, yo, be a father. If not, why bother, son? A boy can make them, but a man can raise one. If you did it, admit it, then stick with it. Don't say it ain't yours, cause all women are not whores. 90% represent a woman that is faithful. Ladies, can I hear it?
Thank
when
you.
A girl gets pregnant. All
right, folks, good morning to you. Rip Daniels here. Thank you for joining us. The show is called The New Day. There's only one rule. There's no such thing as a right or wrong opinion. You know what's interesting about this is LaMello's, 4-month-old LaMello's last name was Parker, and it was not Smith. That tells me something about the deceased mother, and that is obviously she did not feel that Smith was worthy of carrying the baby's last name. And that's what it tells me. Or, because nowadays, needless to say, you can, in fact, without matrimony, have the baby can be named after, get the last name of his father, which I think shouldn't happen. I really do. I think when that changed, it changed a lot of things. And this mother of five, up until Tuesday, obviously felt that Smith was not worthy. Maybe Smith felt that he should be. Now, don't get me wrong. I think if Smith felt that way, he should have married the mom in the first place. All right, 228-896-9455. Maybe she knew something we didn't, and she should have known it probably before she had little LaMello. But that's after the fact. She's gone, he's gone. But I'm sure this will come up. This is the reason why I brought this up. My concern, and only my concern, is why a 4-month-old was shot. My concern. Can I go to, is it Simelda? No? Yes? Oh, Mr. Jones. All right. Good morning, Mr. Jones.
Good morning. Good morning, Rip. How you doing?
Doing well, sir.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir, I can.
Okay. I also, just like the last gentleman, believe they should be fired. They shouldn't be having a desk job right now, because when the pursuit first started, I'm sure that everybody joining the pursuit got on that same frequency, and they was aware that he had a weapon. And he had a child. So I know we established that already for those who don't believe.
Well, it has not been established. I want you to know that literally has not been established based on what Chief Miller said. Go ahead.
Well, you know how a pursuit go. Once they start a pursuit crossing those lines, don't everybody get on that channel? And they're listening to the wire. You know, everybody have they're listening. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm sure somewhere down the line those dispatchers informed those officers again and again that that he had a weapon. I'm sure they're going to say a weapon. And there was a baby in that vehicle. My thing to you is I know that the lieutenant and the chief supervisor that was on that scene know it was a bad shoot. And I just want to know why they still have a job right now.
Yeah.
They should be terminated. That was a bad shoot.
Well, they got to do what's called due process, even when it comes down to firing someone. As evidence of that, Atlanta, I take you to Atlanta, where now the officer who shot Blake in the back there in Atlanta is now being reinstated because, according to the review board, he was not fired properly. So they are following procedures, no doubt. Of course, this investigation is being done by the Biloxi PD. And Biloxi PD has no, the only thing they can do is investigate what happened. As far as firing and hiring, that's up to the agencies of those officers who did the shooting. Gulfport.
Understood.
Gulfport, the Sheriff's Department, Harrison County, and, of course, the public safety, which, of course, the state troopers. So, and we've not gotten a confirmation as to the disposition of the state troopers and whether or not whether they have been suspended or whether they are on administrative duties as opposed to administrative leave. But they would be the ones responsible for determining whether or not the policies were followed. In my view, given what I'm seeing regarding the policies, they were not followed. But there will be a review board, internal investigation, and so forth as to whether they did or did not. What Biloxi's doing is determining whether or not a crime was committed, whether or not there was wrongdoing. They just simply want to say, here is what we found out that happened. There were shots, and here's how many shots, and here's who shot them, and here's the consequences of those shots. And then Biloxi then will present that in such a way that could very well go before the grand jury, but that'll be up to the district attorney of Harrison County.
Understood. Well, I want to say, Rip, that I truly believe that there are some good officers out there. They're going to make a statement about this because they knew that was not right. It wasn't justified. And I also feel like those dispatchers or 911 dispatchers, they're going to come forward too and tell the truth that they were warned. They let the officers know, and it shouldn't have happened, you know?
Well, that was we received a BOLA, be on the lookout for, that indicated mm-hmm. that Smith was believed to have kidnapped his 4-month-old from Baton Rouge and potentially was heading in the direction of Mississippi. Now, the question is where was he going? And we've not determined that yet. We don't know whether he had relatives here or not, but I want you to know that my folks are really looking at it. Why come this direction? Was he just trying to, was he on the lam? Why come through Mississippi? I mean, there's a lot of open highway between here and Mississippi, and there's no doubt a whole lot of places to hide.
Uh-huh.
And, I mean, you realize you got to go through, St. Tammany Parish. I mean, there's any number of places he could have ducked off. And then at what point did Baton Rouge get behind him? Of course, their concern was for the child, which is what maybe is reason why he got so far, some 130 miles driving. So
They were aware.
Yeah.
They were aware.
Yeah.
And my last question to you, and I'm going to let you go. Can they get to the coroner is my question. Can they get to him?
What do you mean?
And have him change his statement on behalf of the city so it won't be trouble here in the city or whatnot? Can they direct him, in other words, to say what they need him to say to make this go away?
All right. Okay. Mr. Jones, I appreciate you calling. Let me, I'll answer it this way, Mr. Jones. I want to believe the integrity of the Biloxi chief is such that he would not just change a statement, change evidence, or say something for the sake of keeping calm. I don't see people jumping up and down in the streets here in Biloxi or Gulfport about this. I really don't. I don't. That very rarely do you see protests like that. And let me just say something else to the credit of Chief Miller. When Officer McKeithen was killed right there in front of the headquarters in Biloxi 2 years ago, his behavior and how he handled this was honorably. For him to keep a lid on his officers and keep his officers from doing what I'm sure they felt compelled to do because a fellow officer had fallen, a friend, a father. I don't doubt the capture of those of the assailant, the alleged shooter, murderer, and those who helped him had to be done very professional. Very professional. So I tell you what, I feel just as strong about Chief Miller investigating this and being in charge of this as I would anybody. I really, really do. Now, with that said, your question was whether or not, you know, someone can get to the coroner. The coroner doesn't answer to Chief Miller. He's a county coroner that's elected. Do I think that the coroner will change his mind or what he said? By one resource was quoted as saying that Smith was sitting in the driver's seat. Chief Miller indicated in his press release that at what point, here's what he said, I'm quoting him, as the suspect exited the vehicle, shots were fired. He did not say that the suspect fired those shots. He said, I'm reading verbatim from his press release on the 3rd. At mile marker 40 eastbound I-10, the suspect drove into the grass median and became stuck. As the suspect exited the vehicle, shots were fired. I think him saying, not saying that the suspect fired is quite telling. He didn't know. What we didn't see in the video was the suspect exiting. Of course, our view, the only views we've had, is actually from the passenger side.
Right.
I'm sure there will be views from the driver's side, and more than likely that will come from law enforcement. This was in the eastbound lane. All traffic had stopped flowing in the eastbound lane, and well, that's not true, bro. It had not. The film we saw from the passersby was from the eastbound. They had obviously pulled over.
Right. Or were stopped in that you know, that area after the car, right around when the car was stopped, finally immobilized from that last spike strip.
Yeah.
We don't have confirmation, though.
Yeah. All right, 228-896-9455. There has to be a reasonable explanation as to why there was a decision to fire into a car that had a four-month-old baby. And innocent. Can I go to Cabman? You're next. Where are you right there? Good morning, Cabman.
Good morning, Mr. Daniel. Thanks for taking my time. Good morning, everybody. So you have some statements now, and when this man got stuck in the meeting, got out of the car, was he shooting back at the police at this time?
That's unconfirmed. It's unconfirmed that he even got out. The chief said the suspect exited the vehicle. We did not see that.
When he got stuck, they just opened fire on the car.
I'm sorry?
Was the police just opened fire on the car when the car got stuck in the meeting?
Yes.
Well, is that probable cause to open fire before you, I guess, do your preliminaries, tell the man to get out the car, do something?
Well, there was some shouting. It was not audible. What we did see was something at the top of the driver's side, something black at the top of the driver's side door. It was either a hand, a phone, and it could have very well have been a gun, but it was at the top. And it's interesting that it was there, and shortly thereafter is when the shots rang out. Right, bro? You've isolated
right.
that, huh?
Right.
So there's nothing on the recording that the police saying, put your hand on the car, don't move, or nothing like that.
We don't have any of that information. What we have here, what you can see very visibly, was that there was a maneuver to spin the car out, and it did. It had four flat tires by then, and it ended up in the median, and the trooper's car, and appreciate your calling. Go online and take a look at this too, Catman, if you would. The deputy's car, cruiser, ended up directly behind. They're calling this an Altima. It didn't look like an Altima, the blue Altima.
Yeah, this is a Sentra or a Versa, perhaps.
And then there was a highway patrol car directly in front. Both of the officers exited their vehicles. No shots fired from Smith. No shots fired. No shots fired from Baton Rouge to Biloxi. Now, that doesn't mean that you trust a man who has a gun who's acting deranged and a potential or suspect for a double homicide. Doesn't mean that, okay, he can't fire at any given time. That goes without saying. Still dangerous. However, there are some things you measure here. You know, as a person just trying to, instead of escalating this situation, trying to bring it to a close. It was coming to a close. The decision is how will it end? And of course, Smith can determine that as much as law enforcement. But when law enforcement decides it for a four-month-old, then they're culpable. They're culpable. And the decision to take that shot those shots has to be asked, has to be dealt with. I'm going to go to Bobby. Bobby, good morning.
Good morning, Riff. How you doing this morning?
I'm doing Riff, fair. Yeah.
I was going to call you with some good news. Riff, this right here disturbed me pretty bad right now. With all of the technology that we have, Riff, why, I just don't understand why they opened up so fast and started firing in this car. I'm trying to figure out, like, what the heck was he going to go with a flat tire and about 20 to 30 police officers? Where was he going to go?
Well, he still could be lethal in their view. In other words, he still could jump out shooting.
It don't really matter if he was shooting at them or what. All that cover they have, I'm trying to figure out, what do they have, negotiators for, hostage negotiators? At the end of the day, real, even if he shot at them, they have so much cover that they could have took. They could have took a lot of cover before they just start flying in a car or just shooting in a car. That doesn't make any sense, man. And anybody that look at it this kind of way, it's justified, something is wrong with them if they don't see the bigger picture of this, real.
Yeah, no doubt about that in my view. Appreciate you calling, Bobby. So, just so you'll know, ladies and gentlemen, there are circumstances such that a police officer should not, by policy, use lethal force. And I want you to know, you don't have to use the connotation. It clearly says it when you pull up police response to hostage situations. This, unlike lethal force, whereby that you use lethal force when you feel that your life is in danger. This says quite the contrary. It says do not use force when you can put the hostage or the victim at risk. You got to understand what we're dealing with here, ladies and gentlemen. We're not dealing with a fast-moving situation. That stopped. That stopped a long time ago, way around Pastor Stan. We're not dealing with that. We're dealing now with a hostage taking. We're dealing now with a person who is immobile. Time now is on the side of law enforcement. And it clearly states, we don't have Belux Gulfport yet or the sheriffs yet. This is coming from, what is this? Chicago? I don't know. When officers are confronted with a lethal, with a hostage situation, the first consideration has to be the victim. The safety of the victim. Who is the victim here? Who is the person being kidnapped? It is a 4-month-old. Where is the 4-month-old? In the car. So under no circumstances should you put that victim at risk as a result of our behavior, law enforcement behavior, and you represent us. You have the ability to take cover. If and only if that hostage is being threatened with bodily harm, only then does it say that law enforcement officers can take that risk to prevent the hostage. There have been times, ladies and gentlemen, I don't doubt that law enforcement have taken that risk, and unfortunately, the hostage, as well as the assailant, has both been killed. No evidence that baby's life was in danger by the kidnapper. If, in fact, things to change, sir, who asked that question, whether or not the coroner or whoever, the circumstance here would drastically change if it is determined that Smith shot his own baby. Didn't kill the baby, because you heard the baby cry after Smith was dead. You can play it. Smith's dead, baby cries. So, would that mean that, well, that Smith still didn't shoot his child? He could have, but didn't kill the child. That would have to be the argument. But even then, Rip Daniels now would say that it was negligence to even fire. It was negligence to even fire on that vehicle. I'm going to go to Lloyd. Lloyd, good morning.
Hey, how you doing? My comment is, you know, and I realize I had a right to be wrong. If there had been a mayor's child, a governor's child, Congress, senator, or even president, it goes back to what a sniper said. One shot, one kill. Well, I look at it, them officers just looked at, hey, I got an opportunity to fire my weapon. So they just shot up the car. And no consideration of the child.
Why? Why do you think they would take that position? Because it wasn't an elected official?
Because it what now?
Because it wasn't an elected official? In other words, it was no one imparted, and so therefore?
Yeah. I mean, I tell you what, do you think they would have shot in that car like that if it had been some government official or child, whatever?
No.
No. Well, we know that. Yeah. Without a fact. Like I say, if they had to shoot, sniper should have been on hand because they knew where they were going to stop the car at. And one shot, one kill.
There was because one individual.
They had the highway blocked off, huh?
Right. Yeah, they had the eastbound lane blocked off, but not the westbound, which was odd. And they had, there was one individual with a long rifle directly in front of the driver's side. And he was the one that caught the dog. But it didn't look like he fired a shot, bro. Looks like when the shooting started, the dog started coming his direction and he grabbed the dog.
Yeah. There's nothing to.
But he did have a long rifle. Didn't it look like looks like an AR.
Definitely,
there.
Yeah.
Well, it was one Biloxi cop had a long rifle because I was there. And the westbound lane wasn't stopped. I saw when the car went over in the immediate whatever. And
so it looked like the car, the chief said that he drove it into the median, but it looked like that the deputy's car pushed. He did a spin-out maneuver and pushed the car into the median. Where were you exactly, Lloyd?
I was in the westbound lane. You know, I kind of saw when the car, when they was following behind him and the car went in the lane. What caused it, you know, I was too far away to see that.
Right, I see.
But, you know.
So you didn't you didn't pull on the side of the road. You were just traveling.
No, I ain't pull on the side of the road. You know,
I'm glad you didn't, bro.
You know, either way, I didn't know what was going on. Right. All I know, they had enough police cars behind him that I mean, to me, it looked like it was about a quarter mile long behind. And I know all the exits was blocked on the eastbound lane when I was coming up the westbound lane.
I'm curious as to why. Was there any attempt to stop the westbound traffic?
No.
That's
like
just,
I say, we were steady going.
See, I would have thought with a hostage situation that could be very lethal here, I would have thought that the highway patrol and the protocol would be to stop, block both lanes, especially when you had some idea as to where you were going to try to take the assailant. You know what I'm saying? That's just odd.
Yeah, they knew they were just going to take him right there because they had cars cross the highway, and he would have had run into the cars or went in the median.
So you mean there were patrol cars on the off the westbound lane at that point? In other words, when you going westbound, was there cars in, patrol cars in the median of the westbound lane?
No, they had cars coming across the highway on the eastbound.
Yeah, okay. So it was all on the eastbound. But what I thought I heard you say was that the reason why you knew that they were going to take him there was because there were maybe cars in the westbound lane, which meant that he could not get to the
reason
westbound.
Why I knew he was going to have to, they was going to stop him right there because they had three cars crossing the interstate on the eastbound lane.
Okay, so what do you mean? So they were going eastbound behind him, Did cars jump right in front of him and block it off?
These cars was already parked there before he got there.
I got you. Okay.
They had the highway blocked with three cars.
I got you. In the eastbound lane.
In the eastbound lane. Like I said, he couldn't even go no further on the interstate unless he went into the median.
I got you.
Or whatever. Or go around or run into him. Cause,
I got you.
Like I said, they knew where they was going to stop him at. The helicopter was up overhead and everything. Like I say, and they was traveling ahead and looked like real slow to me. And like it was about a quarter mile long of patrol cars behind him.
Yeah.
That many cars, patrol cars behind him.
Well, that even makes it. That even makes it, in my view, that even makes it more culpable. The fact that they knew that they were going to stop him there. And that just implies to me that that there was a thought that this was going to be the showdown.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was, because like I say, he it was three cars blocking that eastbound lane.
Yeah.
Three patrol cars. I think one was a highway patrol car and sheriff or whatever. I can't remember all what, but it was three cars across there.
All right, Lloyd, appreciate your calling. Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Thank you very much. 228-896-9455. Someone just emailed me. So, Rip, if in fact there is a hostage taking and a sniper is instructed to take out the hostage taker, what is the protocol when it comes to the hostage being killed? Well, everything I'm reading here simply says that hostage cannot be put at risk. That hostage cannot be put at risk. It did not say even if there's a safety of the officer. Here's the thing you got to understand. When in a situation like that, the ones who are controlling the time is law enforcement. Typically, you've got a person who is who's surrounded. Can't get away. So at any given time, the officers are compelled to take cover. Now, of course, like I said, you're going to have Captain America out there who feels that he's not going to do that, and that's his prerogative, so he puts himself at risk and then say, okay, yeah, my life was in danger. Dumbass that he could be. It's not how you do things. But the idea of using lethal force and saying that I will use it when my life is in danger is also, there was a court action here. What was it the Kern report or something like that, whereby There's a reasonable expectation that your life is in danger. Any officer would think that there's a reasonable expectation your life is in danger. You cannot jump from in front of a police car while you know an assailant is armed and shoot that assailant because you feel, okay, my life, is a reasonable possibility I'm going to get shot. It was before that, before you jumped in front of it. You didn't, that was an unreasonable action that you took. I'm going to the phones. Who is the next? Witness, good morning.
At some point, really quickly, we have to get this man who had the child in the car full responsibility for it. He was wrong. He allegedly committed a crime. He could have de-escalated it at any time. And when you're not guilty, it's your duty to de-escalate it for yourself as well as the police who may feel you're going to harm them or things like that. You have to do what you can to not let things get that way. So this man allegedly committed this crime. He rode all this way to do what? When he could have got the baby out the car somehow and de-escalated it. Now, my thing is,
We already heard your opinion, witness. You said if they knew there was a baby in the car, they shouldn't have shot.
Right.
Is what you said. That's your opinion, right? Or have you changed it?
I don't think that it was. I don't think it was 100% their knowledge. I think that they may have estimated that he had the baby.
The Bola.
I don't think it was 100% sure.
Even the passerby heard. So did I hear. It's Ebola. Be on the lookout for Smith.
Right.
Perceived riding.
That doesn't mean that he had the baby.
Excuse me, sir.
If they said he had the baby, that's not the same thing.
You do understand. it is perceived, even if it's perceived that he has a child on board. That's enough.
Mm-hmm. Well, in your opinion, it is. But they have to have some definitive answers for things.
You've already made your opinion. You said your opinion yesterday. You said they should not have shot, right?
We can't keep condoning.
All right. You just, you know, you're going on and on. You're a piece of work. Here, bro. I know you queued it up yesterday when he said that, but I don't want to hear that. You know, got witness. So who is it you're trying to defend? I mean, you know, must this always be some kind of in defense of the indivisible? Just because what? I don't know what you. I make no bones about the fact that I support law enforcement. Chief Miller knows I do that. This broadcast and this station works more with law enforcement than any other station. I guarantee you, any chief of police would say that. I guarantee you that. We're the only station doing what we do. We're the only station doing crime and consequences. We're the only station going to schools and meeting with kids and handing out cards that says, here are the sentences for doing this kind of misdemeanor or felony. We're the only ones. We're the only ones. Point is that there are things and there are people under the color of law who shouldn't be there. And there has to be a purge. You have to weed out individuals who will have some agendas and exercise some discretions that are not becoming of the law enforcement or the citizens that they represent. Can I go to Daryl or Galloway? Galloway's next. Good morning, Galloway. I'm going to go through these calls very, very quickly. Good morning.
All right, real quick, Mr. Daniels, I want to, first of all, to say this. The officers are officers that shot into that car. They know which person shot that baby. And the reason why I'm saying this, as a trained professional, you know how to count the rounds as you shoot, and being at that close proximity, less than 50 feet, you know who actually pulled that trigger to kill that child.
You'd have to know where the child is, wouldn't you? Have to know where the child is in the car itself?
At that, being that close, Mr. Daniels, it's no way they, unless those windows were pitch black dark. Hmm. That's the only way they couldn't have seen that child in the car. If you look at the video that y'all put up there, you can see that these police officers are looking. And you got a police officer in the back, you got him on the side, you got him in the front.
Keep in mind the windows are tinted on this Nissan.
What's that?
The windows were tinted?
On this vehicle that the father was driving, yes.
What percentage of the tint? I hate to get technical like that, but it, to me, being that in that close, it's no way you didn't know. But what I wanted really to call is to look up the case in Louisiana, Derek Stafford. See how many years he got when they didn't know a child was in the car. He did a police chase. The guy finally stopped, supposedly put his hands up, and they shot a six-year-old boy six times.
Yep.
That man is serving 40 years in prison, day for day, without probation.
You failed to mention that he was an African-American patrolman, too.
Yeah, he was a black cop that shot a white kid.
That's correct. Just thought I'd put that in. Such was the case with Norrett as well there in Minnesota. Yeah, when an African-American cop does something similar, trust me on this, they throw the book at him.
But I just really believe, from my training experience, 20 years in a combat MOS, somebody that close, I know how many rounds I shot, and I know exactly my line of sight. Unless y'all doing some Mississippi burning cowboys on the back of a pickup truck running around shooting people, which I seriously doubt it, because that looked like some well-aimed shots. Because if you notice, those shots were not placed all over the car. Even the ones that were coming from the back, it seemed like they were going towards that driver's seat. So maybe I'm wrong, but that's what I just got to say. Y'all have a good day, Mr. Dane.
Appreciate it, Galloway. We'll be back.
Get the info. Get the info.
Stay informed. It's a new day with Rip Daniels, the number one talk show in South Mississippi on Jay-Z 94.5.
All right, folks, good morning to you, Rip Daniels. Let me tell you, what is happening in the Republican Party is the same thing that happened in the Democratic Party in the early 1970s, around 1972. I'll explain after the top of the hour. It will be very, very clear. You'll understand what is happening now to Liz Cheney, Miss Conservative, the most conservative, Dick Cheney's baby, daughter, I might add. And it is really something quite scary when I explain this to you, and you'll see it very, very clear. If you're a conservative, you don't want to miss this explanation, because there, but by, the grace of God, will go the Republican Party. 228-896-9455. Mike, you're next. Good morning, Mike. Thank you for being patient.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
My take on the whole thing, they knew a baby was in the car because there was a federal announcement across the radio. And if it was a bank situation, you got a hostage. You got to do everything you can to preserve the hostage. They could have shot a tear gas thing in, a beanbag around, break the window out so they can see what he was doing. There was other means and methods that could have been done.
Why didn't they use those? Why didn't they use those methods?
I don't know that. Of course, I got to ask them.
Yeah. Let me ask you, what would satisfy you? What would satisfy you with this investigation? Of course, you are not, and I are not privy to all of the evidence. But what explanation would be a good enough explanation for why this 4-month-old was killed?
Well, I feel the cops should be treated just like if I went out and shot somebody. It should be the same thing. You can't use your badge for excuse. You did wrong, you know you was doing wrong.
Yeah. All right.
I was there. I watched everything. I watched them spin him out, and I watched the whole thing unfold.
Did you?
I watched it. Yeah. They had plenty of officers out there with long guns. In a situation like that, there should have been an officer dedicated. They had snipers there with long rifles.
So let me ask you this, Mike. Did you see him get out of the car, as the chief said?
I never seen him get out of the car. I was on the westbound side. When all the shooting started, they had an officer over on the westbound side that he got out and started shooting at them. And that's when the other two cops left real fast. That's why we thought maybe an officer got shot or something. Because that's right, immediately after the shot stopped, they had two vehicles left real fast and leaving out of there. I said, well, the officer must have got shot or something. They were trying to get them out of there. Because I was less than 75 yards from it. And that's when the officer told us we need to move on, start moving on.
Hmm. And so
it was handled wrong. It should have been dedicated. You should have had, in a situation like that there, you got the guys just in the front of it that was leading it. They should have went to the rear. The ones from the rear should come up because they have a little different train of thought and took over the situation because the ones that's up front was all amped up.
So let me ask you this. Were you able to see someone in his car?
No, you couldn't see in the car. The windows was super dark.
They were dark. And
yeah, that's what I'm saying. They train. You got to identify your target.
Right.
You're not going to shoot in a bank with tinted windows just because you know somebody in there to get them.
So let me ask you this. So did you hear them shout out anything to the driver?
No, I couldn't hear him shoot anything. I had been sitting there for about 5 minutes before he pulled up and they spent him out. And then it was about another 2 or 3 minutes after they spent him out before the shooting started.
So it was 2 or 3 minutes. So he had been sitting there. Did you see the dogs?
Yeah. No, I couldn't see the dog from the point I was, but I've got the video and film to show that he's been sitting there a couple minutes before the shoot started.
All right, I want you to hold on, Mike. If you've got the video, I want you to hold on. We'd like to, if you don't mind, I'd like to just see that. Is that okay?
That's fine.
All right, hold on. Hold on a minute. 228-896-9455. Go ahead and deal with that, if you would, Amelia Rowe. Can I get Daryl in? Daryl, thank you for being patient.
Hey, Rip, how you doing today?
Doing well.
Hey, I was just going to tell you, I had two, call them barricaded suspects with hostages and law enforcement. And one, we had the guy open fire on us when we first arrived at the scene, and we knew there were other people in the house, so your whole procedure on that is to take cover and call for SWAT to come out and handle it in our case, and we would then pull back to set up a perimeter. And no, you do not ever take a chance of shooting if you know that there's someone inside the house other than the suspect, because no one wants to shoot a hostage for one thing, but it's against departmental policy to fire into a hostage situation when you know there's a hostage situation. But you had a comment someone called earlier about them being shot at.
Hang on, Daryl. My audience may not know that.
To be shot
that.
Hey, Daryl, hang on. Some of my audience may not know that you're a former veteran police officer. When we come back, I want you to pick up where you left off. We'll be back.
Get the info. Get the info.
Stay informed. It's a new day with Rip Daniels, the number one talk show in South Mississippi on Jay-Z 94.5.
There's a little man down in Arkansas, yeah. Everybody calls him Uncle Gizzo. The little old man could sing so good. Oh, he should have been up in Hollywood, yeah. The way the little man play his guitar, you know he should have been a movie star going.
This is Bobby Rush. Got a street named after him, or at least they're trying to, there in Jackson. You know, he built his house himself. He's a cement finisher.
Renaissance man.
All right, folks, good morning to you. Rip Daniels here. Thank you for joining us. He's also an incredible guitar player and harp player. 228-896-9455. That's the number to call. The show is called It's a New Day. There's only one rule. No such thing as a right or wrong opinion. I'm not letting this go, folks. We can't let it go as a society. You know, an innocent life is taken anywhere in this country, especially by those who are tasked with maintaining law and order. It defines us as a society. You know, you've heard some of the conservatives, I call them, call in and go, well, blacks are killing blacks every day. What about that? The question to that is, associate officers act like criminals to Negroes? Just think about it. That is no comparison. If you can't call the Popo, who can you call? Ghostbusters? The law represents all of us, and all of us have to be equal under the law. And the only thing that we've had in this problem is that bigots, and unfortunately some of them don't admit that they are, don't feel that all life is important. That's why Black Lives Matter. That's why people say Black Lives Matter. There are individuals who feel that Black lives don't matter. There's no doubt all lives matter, but in the eyes of bigots, some bigots, Black lives don't. And that's the only way you can give that explanation. And I want you to know it was during the Johnson administration that he tasked a commission of nothing but Caucasian males to investigate why it was that there was so much racial unrest and of course, during the riots. And they came back to determine that, well, there was two different Americas. Justice was not applied equitably. Needless to say, Johnson went out, and then the law enforcement president came in. That was Richard Nixon, and it got worse. And it's been that way since that time, to be quite frank. All right, 228-896-9455. I want to go back to Daryl here, who is a former veteran police officer, and I'm glad you called, Daryl, and weighed in on that hostage policy, because I want you to know it's across the board. I'm looking at it here. We've not seen Gulfports yet or the counties yet, but I don't doubt it's no different. You never do something that's going to put the life of the hostage at risk. Am I right on that?
Yeah, that's correct. I did my policing in Indiana, and as far as I know, that's pretty much a universal policy. That's why you, as officer, you know, officer safety is important. That's why you are working from a point of cover so that you have time to respond and maintain your perimeter. You know, it's all about containment at that point, and make sure that the suspect can't get away until SWAT or whoever can come on scene and take over and handle the situation. And that was just really in response to an earlier call you had who made a comment about being shot at. Being shot at has nothing to do with it. You're going to be shot at from time to time. That's unfortunately part of the job. But the point I wanted to make really, Rip, was about the shooting. From what I've seen in the video, man, and it's something that you'll see in a lot of police action shootings, one officer fires, and everybody thinks that he has seen something that they're not aware of, and that's when your volley starts.
Mm-hmm.
And that's something we're going to need to look at. We need to know who fired the first shot, because that's what set everything off. And that's not to excuse the police officers. but it is to give a reason as to why they will fire, because they think someone has seen something that has led them to think they do need to shoot. And you'll get guys that, unfortunately, we have to use the term the way it is, trigger happy.
Yeah.
That have been waiting to shoot anyway, and now that they're here's an opportunity to shoot, they jump on board. Because you'll look at the video, you'll see it's not like every officer on the scene, you know.
That's correct. Let me ask you, is it not protocol to, at the very least, with all the officers there, for them to be on the same wavelength, same cell phone, same radio band, to understand that there are certain marksmen who will do the shooting and those marksmen only? In other words, I'm trying to figure out, you know, why would there be, now you've got a Gulfport PD officer who is accused or suspected to be one of the shooters. You've got a deputy, sheriff's deputy, the same, and then several highway patrolmen. So I'm just trying to figure out, in a situation like that, that now has stopped being a chase and has now been basically a still hostage situation, are these guys hearing one commander say, okay, Charlie, you're going to take him out. The only shot is going to come from Charlie. Or are they just not listening to anyone else and it's like, oh, I see something, I shoot?
Well, good point. That's what makes me wonder, too, because we know this pursuit came from Baton Rouge. So Gulfport PD really should have just been running the perimeter, and it should have been Highway Patrol on the lead in that pursuit. So Gulfport PD really shouldn't have been there on the scene, since it was a highway incident. You know what I'm saying? It occurred on the interstate.
Right.
So Highway Patrol would have had jurisdiction, even though it may have been in the city of Gulfport. So I would imagine that Highway Patrol commander would have been communicating. And since Katrina, we are supposed to all be able to now communicate as a unit. Like I said, my policeman was in Indiana, so I'm not quite sure of what we've got down here. I jokingly tease that, you know, we're always 10 to 20 years behind here in the South, unfortunately. So I'm not sure if they could communicate, but I know for a fact they would have known we're in pursuit of a murder suspect who is armed and has a hostage, because we know Baton Rouge PD put that out originally.
Right.
So that much everybody would have known about. I'm not sure why Gulfport PD would have been at the lead of that pursuit, though, because it should have been Highway Patrol. And we know of that. Hopefully their command and control was at the point where they would know what to do to contain the situation, make sure the guy can't get away, and let him sit in the car for the next 2 hours. I know that sounds horrible, but it's better if we can let time pass and get everybody out peacefully as opposed to rushing in and killing everybody. Because thankfully, in that circular firing squad we saw, no police officers got shot.
So what do you think?
You know what I'm saying? But we could have had a really horrible, it could have been people on the other side of the highway shot. It could have really been a bad situation.
So very quickly, do you think these officers are culpable, and do you think that they should be charged or disciplined?
Most definitely, because like I said, there was no reason for there to have been shooting, period. We've got them blocked. Everybody's got a point of cover. Everybody's got a car with an engine blocked. That's where it should have stayed. Guns out, pointed at the car, loudspeaker, one person talking to him, trying to get it done. There's no reason to have approached the car. There's no reason to have done anything but keep him. He stopped. He can't go any further. He's not a threat to anyone other than the child in the car.
All right.
That's the only person that he really had an immediate threat. And so, yeah, they should be held culpable. They definitely should be fired, no doubt. They should not be police. And then whether or not criminal charges, that's, you know, unfortunately, that's that letter of the law. That's going to be a harder case, I'll be honest with you.
Yeah. All right, Daryl. Appreciate it. Be safe. We'll be back, folks.
WJZD-FM Long Beach. Bay St. Louis. Wiggins. Moss Point. The all-new JZ 94.5.
Time for jazz at Lim. I know you're thinking this George Benson is not. This is the brand new Norman Brown. I like it.
It's real good.
What's the name of this album?
The name of the album is Heart to Heart.
Heart to Heart.
The name of the track is Just Groovin'.
I'm just groovin'. So when did this come out? I mean, it just came out?
Yeah, this came out at the end of last year.
All right.
Newest album from the man that got me into jazz.
You know, I can't wait to go out and listen to some live entertainment up close and personal.
Seabreeze.
Well, it's coming up. Seabreeze already happened.
Oh, it did happen.
It's gonna happen at the Amonette tour before it's all over. All right, I guarantee now. You. Yes, Lord. Gotta have some good picking here. And some good blowing. 228-896-9455. That's the number to call. Show's called The New Day. There's only one rule now. There's no such thing as a right or wrong opinion. Just putting you on notice, Mississippi. I'm not gonna let this go. Until there's a reasonable explanation as to why 9-year-old LaMello was killed. The only reasonable explanation I could that can even remotely be is that the father decided to kill his son. Even then, there's no reasonable explanation for why that car was lit up, as the passerby said. Folks, there's got to be. We have got to have a reasonable expectation that those who are in law enforcement will do more than just protect their own ass. You heard me right. You heard me right. Well, I was in fear of my life. It's got to be more than just you, my friend. Don't put that damn uniform on. There are those of us in the civilian world who know better than that. There are those of us who've broken up fights, those of us who've challenged individuals who were armed. Trust me on this. And we weren't nearly as trained as you are, and we didn't have the equipment. But you've got to think more about someone else besides yourself. Or, in my book, you shouldn't have the uniform on. That doesn't mean you go out here willy-nilly. You can't stand out in front of someone who has a gun and say, put the gun down. And then when that person doesn't put the gun down, shoot that person and say, I'm in fear of my life. In my view, that dog doesn't hunt anymore. Especially given the position that we've been put in by conservatives. And their willingness to make us in the Dodge City and everybody be armed. Just, yesterday. Now you've got the Texas legislature or the Louisiana legislature is now pushing to make, you can have concealed weapons without a license. Folks, look, I'm a multi-gun owner. But we are letting these cowards push us to the point whereby we're back in Dodge City. It just...
That was Louisiana's house that breezed through yesterday.
I knew it was one of them on that end. I mean, look, folks, this doesn't make sense. We can't get here. You can't have a free society that is walking around paranoid and having castle doctrines such that any one of us can say, well, I was in fear of my life. Let's assume that you have a gun. Remember the movie, what is it, Forgotten? When Clint Eastwood walks in, Unforgiven, he walks in and he shoots the guy. And the sheriff says, you just shot an unarmed man. To which Clint says, well, he should have armed himself.
Well, sir, you are a cowardly son of a bitch. You just shot an unarmed man.
Well, he should have armed himself. He's going to decorate his saloon with my friend.
He should have armed himself. That's where we're going. 228-896-9455. In case you didn't know it, you'll know it now. The baby, LaMello is his name, 4-month-old, was shot once, according to the coroner. No one is saying who shot the child. a Gulfport PD, a sheriff's deputy, and several state troopers have now been placed on administrative leave or desk jobs pending this investigation, and it's being done by the Biloxi PD. Chief Miller's in charge. The only thing we got for him is a press release. A Gulfport and a Gulfport officer and a deputy, Sheriff Harrison County deputy, has also been. No one has been named as to being shooters. No one has even said how many shots, except it's over 20. Roe did a count based upon our analysts here of the number of shots. Come up with over 30, 34 maybe. However, there's protocols, ladies and gentlemen, from using deadly force. And that's very, very, it's clear. Very clear. And then using deadly force when it comes to a hostage situation. And that's what you had here. But some people didn't obviously take note of that. All right, 228-896-9455. McKinney, push you to the front. Good morning, ma'am.
Hey, good morning, Rip.
Yes.
I have a theory about cops when they have multiple shootings on the scene like that.
What is it?
Mine is that you have all these cops, they all have their guns drawn. It only takes one person to fire a shot, right? I think they must have a silent code that if one person shoots, everybody's going to shoot. That way you can't differentiate who was shot first or anything. And also all of them are complicit. So when they investigate them, they have to all, you know, they all can, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, that's what my theory of why I think they all shoot and shoot so much, so many bullets.
Well, how about, you know, I don't know whether they have a code. I don't doubt, however, that if they're not communicating with each other and someone fires a shot, how do they know it wasn't one of their own that fired a shot? Particularly if there's individuals trigger happy. Yeah,
well, they don't have to know. I think if one person shoots, they all gonna protect this one person by everybody shooting. That way you get, like now, we don't know who did it, how many shots it was, which shot killed what person. You know what I'm saying?
You don't. So you think all are complicit though? All are culpable, regardless.
I think they have a thing. Well, you know, you say in the cold, but you know, in any kind of job, you kind of all get together and y'all have this thing that y'all do that nobody knows that you do. Right. I think that they all. Well, I kind of saw this on the cop show too, and it happened. That's what happened. And this one lady, she didn't shoot, right? So because she didn't shoot, they were all mad with her, right? So the investigator was able to separate her, and they found out that the guy they shot, why they shot, and all that kind of stuff. That's just my theory. It just got me thinking.
All right, McKinney. Appreciate it. Can't say I disagree.
All right.
I don't know. The question is, was there a reason to? It's a question. John, you're next. Good morning.
Hey, good morning.
Yeah, good morning, sir.
How you doing today?
Doing well.
I just want to voice my opinion on that whole matter, and I feel like anybody, any officer that was out there that fired their weapon should be fired. If there was a superior officer that gave an order to fire, they should be fired because they had the tactical advantage. We can sit here and talk about training and what they should have done and what happened, but, you know, it's accountability at the end of it. And it's sad to say, but the reality of it is there was probably at least one person out there thinking, oh, we can get two for one. He'll probably end up like his daddy, you know, knowing that this was a child in the car. And, I mean, that's just kind of where we are in today's society with the law enforcement, you know.
So you think that some officers was not empathetic at all toward the 4-month-old, and so it didn't really matter?
It was another day at the office. And like I heard a couple people saying before, you get those guys, they get that badge, they get that gun, and the thing that they're worried about most is the time that they get to use those weapons. They're not worried about using them for the right reason. They just want to use them, you know? And in any given situation where it arises and they get the chance to, then that's what they do. And I hope the child has some family out there, somebody they should have the whole interstate blocked off right now. There should be protests going on. It's just, it's a terrible thing that happens down here. You know, it's just a, it's a horrible thing to happen anywhere. But, you know, to see something like that, it's just terrible.
All right. Appreciate you calling. 228-896-9455. I don't know if Biloxi PD was on the scene. I don't doubt they were. It was in Biloxi. My compliments to those guys. They obviously exercised some restraint. They acted far more professional, should I say, than others who were on the scene, which is why now Biloxi is doing the investigation. That speaks volumes. I just got this email from someone. Rip, do you really believe that the officers who participated in this woke up that morning and said they want to go out and kill a four-month-old? No, I don't think those officers woke up and said, I want to go out and kill a four-month-old. By no means do I think that. Let me tell you what I do think. I do think that there were some officers who said, I don't care if there's a four-month-old in the car. I think that was decided. Do I think they woke up and said they were going Negro hunting for a four-month-old? No. I do think that there are those in uniform who very callously relegate some people to not even being human, even being subhuman. Human debris, I think Rush and Limbaugh used to say. I believe that. And once someone has done that and then set themselves out to protect the public, they then become a threat to some members of the public. I've got a long list of people I could name here that can prove my point, the most recent of which you can start with Derek Chauvin. This was not good police work. 228-896-9455. Let's go to Philip. Philip, good morning.
Good morning, Rip. I heard you talk a little while ago about the castle doctrine and the don't retreat laws and everything else. And when they were being contemplated in Florida, all kinds of people were predicting Dodge City and there'd be people dropping in the streets. And that absolutely did not come to pass. I also find it interesting that in this case today, and in many, many, many cases, I hear you reference fictitious movies that are made for entertainment purposes as the basis for your opinion. And it always causes me to scratch my head as to why anybody would think that a movie that's designed to sell tickets and entertain people is ever used as a basis for reality.
So you think, so after all I've said, that's what you've gotten out of this? Is that what you've gotten out of this? I appreciate your call, Philip. Thank you very much. Have a nice day.
Actually,
Roe found a clip. Roe found a clip because of my concern. I don't have to give you an explanation. Now, if you want to sit there and you want to feel arrogant enough to give some evaluation, then you can go ahead and do it, but you won't do it on my dime. So the sum total of your opinion is, who gives a damn about a four-month-old, Rip? You're talking about a movie. Is that what you're telling me? You've already told me that. You've already told me that beyond a shadow of a doubt, it doesn't make a difference to you that a four-month-old was killed by grown-ass men who had... That's exactly what you said when you said... When you said what you said yesterday, look, it's all clear to me. Thank you. Don't bother. We have your opinion. We know exactly the extent to which you give a damn. You made it very clear. You made it very clear. If you want to sit down and evaluate Rip Daniels, then guess what? I just did you. You should have spent more time giving your opinion about something beyond Rip Daniels, something that you do about. What you don't know about, however, what you don't know about is what it's like to be a black person sitting in that car. You don't know about that. You'll never know, and you'll never, ever want to know, because after all, for you to do that, you'd have to put yourself in the Negro shoes, and who, heaven forbid you did that, you won't be able to go to the deer camp. Oh, you're gone. See, I dismiss you. See, I just did that? Easy. Because you, sir, just decided that, all right, so now you want to make this about Rip Daniels. Well, I just made it about you now. I just made it about you, and I know you very well. Very well. I deal with your kind a whole lot. And in spite of your kind, Rip Daniels is still here. Just saying.
Oh, you want to equate it with Dodge City? You talk about movies.
Here's a guy who would defend Derek Chauvin. Oh, yeah, well, you got to give the benefit of the doubt, and so therefore I can't believe my own eyes. Some of you guys really need to go online. You realize you can listen to this broadcast on Podbeam or on YouTube. You need to go back and hear when you call me. You need to go back and hear and listen to just how callous you sound. You really, really do. And then you'll understand why some people who are who when they hear you on this show will go, oh, yeah, bro. Oh, he did. Get him, Rip. I don't mind.
No, really.
I don't mind either. Trust me, you know that. Stay in your lane. Can I go to Tommy? Tommy, good morning. How are you?
Yes, sir. Good. How about you?
I'm doing excellent.
I'm a first-time caller.
Thank you.
I lived in North Gulfport for over 20 years, sir.
Good.
My daddy used to own a welding company. Why? They chased that dude for 100 miles. They knew they was going to throw them strips out in front of him. Why wasn't the SWAT team sitting on the side of the road waiting?
Why do you think?
Because somebody dropped the ball.
Yeah.
Because there'd been one shot, and that baby would have still been alive. I'm with you on this.
Yeah. So let me ask you this. I'm trying to figure out, because we got a caller, an eyewitness, who said that the eastbound lane was blocked off. So they knew where they were going to do the maneuver.
Yes, sir. Why didn't they have the SWAT team sitting out there? That's what they for.
Yeah. There was one individual with a long gun that we could see that was literally right in front of the driver's side. But he did not, it didn't seem to me, we didn't see any smoke come from the muzzle of his gun. He was actually the one who grabbed the dog after the dog had ran around the car.
Right.
Well, he was more worried about the dog than the baby.
Well, yeah, he was. So what do you think should happen out of this? What do you think should happen out of this, Tommy?
Some of them need to get their life straight and life in order and get rid of some of them because there was no need for that. You know that well as I do.
I do.
I mean, you shoot a gun. Yeah. You know how to shoot a gun.
I do.
Would it took you 34 shots?
I would have never fired somebody? I would have never fired into that car if I knew that was
I know you wouldn't
four have. Months. I wouldn't have done that. The man was the.
And I wouldn't either.
What was the urgency, Tommy, is the question. Now, according
there
to.
There was none.
Well, the chief said that Smith exited the vehicle and shots were fired. Now, he didn't say that Smith fired a shot, but I never once saw on any video where he exited the video. Have you?
No, sir. And the only thing I can tell you is the only way that I'd have shot. And the police officers shot, if he turned and shot that kid,
then
it'd have been a different story.
Oh, you got to take him out.
But there's nothing. That guy didn't kill his own kid. That one right there.
No, I don't think
he
so.
He was fixing to give up, man. You know it well as I do. That was assassination.
All right, Tommy. Appreciate your call. I can tell you. I mean, I'm going to believe my own eyes. I'm going to believe my own eyes now. 228-896-9455. Where are we at? Bud or Tony? Bud, you're next. Good morning.
Hey there, Mr. Riff. How you doing, sir?
Doing well, Mr. Bud.
Yes, sir. Just wanted to piggyback on what everybody was saying. Yes, it just felt like those officers had the opportunity to shine. To kill a black man, they didn't care about that baby that was in the car. All they was focusing on, oh, I'm going to shoot somebody. I got the opportunity to shoot somebody.
So
that
why?
Baby was innocent.
Why then? Why now? Do you think? I'm just trying to in my mind. You know, sometimes what I do is try to say, okay, what was the thinking? Why then, why now, after 130 miles, and now this person has been isolated, four flat tires, sitting in the median?
That's what I'm saying. Yeah, that's what I'm saying, Mr. Rick. Why did he have to take for the person to drive almost 130-some-odd miles from Baton Rouge all the way to Biloxi, Mississippi, followed by at least
50 to 75 officers, cars, units. I mean, I saw it on the highway because the highway is right there by my house. I mean, I actually saw it. Hmm. Why did it take that long to actually stop the car? And then when the car actually stopped, when the officer nudged the car from behind, it spun off. But why did it take that long to subdue him?
Yeah.
And
let me ask you this. You said you were there. There's some contradiction here. And here's a contradiction, and maybe there's some video that I'm not aware of, but according to Chief Miller in his press release, he said the suspect drove into the grass median and became stuck. Now, you and I both saw
negative.
Yeah, that we saw that the deputy actually did a spin out move and
he nudged the back of the car.
He did.
And that's when the car went into the median.
Here's my other question. The chief Miller said in his release, as the suspect exited the vehicle, shots were fired. Now, what I saw was the dogs goes around the car. If had he left out of that car, that dog would have got a hold to him. Don't you think? And did you ever see that?
No, I did not.
I didn't either. Did you see any video on that road? You can see the dog going around the car, and the passerby said, the videoer said, get him, dog. And you don't see him get out of the car.
No.
And had he got out of the car, trust me on this, the dog would have been all over him.
Yeah.
So I'm wondering why that was in this press release.
I'm thinking, and this is just a thought, and I'm not backing any of this up based on anything except for what I've seen and what I've read from this press release and everything we've heard officially so far. I don't think Chief Miller was on scene. So
no,
Chief Miller
no.
is going on what his officers report to him.
Right.
So I think it's important that we indicate that this was reported to Chief Miller, as it appears in his report, the first press release from this incident, the only one from Biloxi PD so far.
Here's my problem with this. This the control of the information. And Bud, I appreciate your calling. Sometimes law enforcement will put out information prematurely that they know may sow seeds of doubt in what someone may say they did. In other words, no one wants to come out and say that the police made a mistake. No one wants to do that. And so the information that happens within the first 24 to 48 hours is very, very crucial. Very crucial to how we, the public, perceive what the response of law enforcement was. What makes that difficult for them is a video. I don't doubt that had we just simply not had a video in the Derek Chauvin case, he would be out right now. He'd still be on the force. Even with Brianna, you know, where there was no video, I want you to know it was almost 4 months before that even came back up. And it had been buried. Brianna didn't even happen there in Louisville. So I think sometimes there's cooperation with journalists. Sometimes there are journalists who will listen to what law enforcement said, even if it's contradictory to what they're seeing, and say, here is what it is. The chief never did once say that the suspect fired a shot in this press release. He didn't even say the suspect had a gun in this press release. As the suspect exited the vehicle, shots were fired. Hadn't seen that video. Seen the dogs running around the car. When the dogs stopped running around the car, shots were fired. To which someone had to grab the dog. An officer had to grab the dog, the one that had the long gun. So I wonder whether or not, and I hear what you're saying. I mean, obviously the chief was not there. He's going by the information he has. However, the chief is compelled to come up with information for release that would hopefully not prejudice a case for or against law enforcement. On the other hand, he realizes and takes responsibility for public reaction, right? Unfortunately. I mean, when you are, of course, his guys were not part of this, so he's doing the investigation, but, you know, a public reaction has, and you guys know this, for the last year, has been egregious in some cases, peaceful in others. And so I don't doubt that in some cases law enforcement can put out tactical information that will hopefully curtail some public overreaction. Although that information may not be accurate, like in the case in Chicago, where the 13-year-old had a gun. He didn't have a gun. He had a gun until he dropped it, and that's what the officer asked him to do. And the officer did not take the time to actually evaluate whether this 13-year-old had a gun, and he killed him. How much time did it take? Nanosecond. 228-896-9455. Can I go to Tony? Tony, good morning.
All right, how you doing, Mr. Dan?
Doing well, Mr. Tony.
I just got a question for you. Are they talking about they found a gun in the car?
No, there's been no confirmation of a gun in the car. Been no confirmation of a gun being fired by the suspect.
Oh man, Mr. Daniels, like I told Ro, it's crazy because they shot for their cashier. It is whole family in the car.
Yeah, and got away with it.
And got away with it.
Yeah, a jury found the officer not guilty.
All right, and in the Derek Chauvin case. They say the guy wearing a black Lives Matter shirt, and what they're trying to do say is a mistrial.
Yep, they're trying to say because he had a T-shirt on. It wasn't a Black Lives Matter T-shirt, actually. It was
a Black Lives T-shirt. He had a Black Lives Matter T-shirt and a Black Lives. It had Martin Luther King on it. Black Lives Matter BLK.
Well, yeah, BLM. Yeah, but it was a Martin Luther King. It was a Martin Luther King T-shirt that was on it, and quote of what Martin Luther King said. And so Nelson, who is Chauvin's lawyer, is trying to say that in fact the juror was prejudiced, but he had already asked the juror how he felt about it, and the juror had already revealed that he's
supported. Yeah, I mean, you have to do that during the when you said in the jury, right?
That's correct. So that was already revealed. That's not a good basis for a new trial.
And I just got one more thing to say. Man, I hope this incident wake your eyes up to how the police really don't give a damn about us, brother. Because you keep calling out Chief, all this old bull. Man, Chief don't care about us. Straight up.
Well, you say that, but you do understand. You do understand, Tony, and you just got away with that. You just hung up. You just grouped the chiefs of police, the chief of a police department, and the chief of police officers who did not retaliate when one of their very own, Officer McKithen, was shot down in the very parking lot of that precinct. Now, I'm going to tell you something. For the Biloxi PD to round up the culprits, including the person who's accused of killing McKithen, and arrest them, not shoot them down, that's good police work. Now, maybe it's good for you to just generalize, but when you talk to Rip Daniels, Rip Daniels is able to evaluate people by what they do, but not by what uniform they have. I have great respect for the uniform, but I may not have respect for all the men in it. But I can't cite a situation there in Biloxi under Chief Miller where I have seen anything remotely as close to what happened to George Floyd or Philando Castile. I'm just saying. See ya. We'll be back.
Get the info.
Stay informed. It's a new day with Rip Daniels, the number one talk show in South Mississippi on Jay-Z 94.5.
Let's be a man. And tell me the truth. Are you trying to take my woman? But I took your woman from you. Just be a man.
Old B. Buchanan, folks.
I
coming to the coast. I got some big blues shows coming up in June. All right, folks, good morning to you. Rip Daniels here. Thank you for joining us. The show is called It's a New Day. There's only one rule. No such thing as a right or wrong opinion. Going to get back to it. But first, folks, I know there's a lot of things going on. Good news on the coronavirus front. Supposedly now there's a hope that we will be doing much, much better come July. Maybe not herd immunity, but at the very least, far fewer infections. But I've got to get into this Republican thing. I've said to you time and time again, and no one has challenged it, no conservative would challenge it because they know I'm telling the truth. What has happened in our country since the beginning of this country is that wherever you find the conservatives, conservatism, period, you're always going to find where we as a country is held back, which is why they're not for progress, i.e. not for progressives, which means they're regressive. They want to maintain where America is, and they do that for control of themselves, maintaining the big guys in the big place, good old boy kind of system. But what's happening right now in the Republican Party is the same thing that happened in the Democratic Party. First and foremost, in the Democratic Party back in the 1960s and 70s, it was inundated with conservatism, segregationist, Jim Crow. All of those are conservative concepts. Have you a conservative and you want to take issue with it, call me. Just have your ducks in a row. I know the history of it. So what happened in 1972 was the same whacked out kind of craziness that Liz Cheney is warning the Republicans about right now. It is the party of personality. It's gone way beyond conservatism. In 1972, one George Wallace, Mr. Conservative, and he's been at the whole all his life, governor of Alabama, ran as a Democrat. There are those of us who were around then. But what he did was, within the convention, what he did was divided the Democratic Party, much like what the double impeach one-termer Donald John is doing right now. It is not about the basis for even what they call conservatism, which is stupid. It's more about Donald John. And I'm going to tell you something. The party right now is seeing the same thing that they saw in Berlin with Adolf Hitler or what they saw with Vladimir Putin there in Russia. It is a party of personality. What those who support the impeached Donald John like about him is his charisma. His policies has failed miserably. Miserably. If the wall was effective, then we would not have had the onslaught that we had. Now just think about it. Just give it some thought. If in fact any of his policies, even toward China, was effective, then we wouldn't have empty shelves right now. We wouldn't have cars skyrocketing and can't find chips. Now, and I'm not just saying it political, because I vote Republican as much as I vote Democrat. It has nothing to do with the fact that I am a Republican, because I'm not. Not a Democrat either. But what happened in 1972, ladies and gentlemen, was that one George Wallace divided the so-called Solid South, the conservatives then. And he won a significant number of states, and all of them were not just in the South, I don't mind telling you. And when you listen to George Wallace, then, of course, quote-unquote segregation at that point supposedly was over. Supposedly, with the exception of, in and around Bahia or D-Law, Mississippi. But when you listen to him, you will hear George Wallace say the same thing as what you're hearing now from the impeached Donald John. And even more importantly, what people liked about him, particularly here in Mississippi, which he won, Alabama, which he won, he didn't become the Democratic nominee, thank God. It was McGovern. And Hoover. But the point is that what he did, his defiance is what the so-called conservatives here like, his defiance. But the subliminal message was he was tapping into white inferiorist and the Klan because he was George Wallace. And they were coming out of the hills to vote for him. And it scared the bejesus out of both Johnson and many others in the Democratic Party, which, by the way, since he didn't win, the Republicans who voted for George Wallace bolted from the Democratic Party and went into the Republican Party. It all started around the 1965 Voting Rights Act, I might add. Johnson knew that. But this party, what is happening right now in the Republican Party, is tantamount to what happened with George Wallace and the platform of personality. Has nothing to do with even Donald John being a conservative, because he's not. I can tell you that. Rush Limbaugh knew he wasn't. Hannity boy knew he's not. But it's all about being able to get a win and look out for his boys, the shady characters that you've seen before. And one last thing, and then I'll go back to Biloxi. I want George. I want Donald John to run. Oh, boy. Boy, let me just tell you, the one reason, the only thing we've got to do is pray that he does, because he's going to pull people out of the woodwork again to vote against him. That's, you want to know why there was such a record-breaking turnout? They want to tell you, oh, yeah, it was a flawed election. No one, the big lie is just that, a big lie. There was no fraud going on. What was going on was people motivated by the complete chaos of the Donald John administration. And the fact that they understood he was a con man. There were as many conservatives who were against him as anyone else, to be quite frank. So I hope he runs. And I'm going to tell you, if Liz Cheney goes out and she's replaced by the Donald John pick, it might work in Congress right now, but I guarantee you, by the 2022 election, I guarantee you, if Donald John now comes back to prominence, you get ready for this. That's going to be another huge turnout. 228-896-9455. That's the number to Carl. Carl, good morning.
Good morning, Rip. How are you doing?
Doing well. Thank you for being patient, Carl.
I still keep up with the happenings on the coast and everything, even though I'm living in Georgia right now. But, I saw the video, on Facebook that you put up and everything. My question is this, and I still haven't found an answer. How do you drive from Baton Rouge to I-10? Louisiana police do not stop you. But as soon as you hit Mississippi, it's like OJ all over again. I-10 is, and I guess I'm not sure if it's, as far as, I don't remember as far as Hancock County, but Harrison County, especially on I-10, who has jurisdiction? Do the highway patrol have jurisdiction? Do the county have jurisdiction? Is Gulfport, the police department, who has jurisdiction?
Well, it is. The state troopers typically are the ones who can issue citations and have jurisdiction over I-10.
Okay, but like I said, we see the vehicle with four flat tires and everything else, and I saw the highway patrol, the vehicles and everything else, I couldn't actually make out, who took the first shot or who was in, but you can hear the gunfire. But it's just a fact that even in previous history, I've always said the same thing like you just said. Highway Patrol has jurisdiction on the interstate,
right?
But we know that, especially in Harrison County, but Biloxi, Gulfport, they rule out there.
You can have corporations between jurisdictions. It's not unusual for the sheriff's department, for instance, to work very closely with the highway patrol because they're county, right? And so there was a county deputy that seemingly in a cruiser did the spin out. And one county deputy right now is on administrative leave. And it hasn't been confirmed. We suspect that he was one of the shooters. So that can be corporation cross jurisdictional in this situation. Usually, however, if you're going to be written a ticket, it will come from a state trooper. Now, this was a little different situation. That is, it was a be on the lookout for in a criminal offense, and so I don't doubt that there was some cooperation.
We've traveled out to the Baton Rouge. You're from 10 to 12. Yeah. There are a lot of state troopers out there on 12.
Yeah, that's right.
How do you allow this to even come across state lines?
All right, I can tell you this, and I'm going to move on, Carl.
Somebody dropped the ball.
The reason why...
I'm going to hang up
and listen. All right, Carl, the reason why the chief of police there in Baton Rouge said that Smith was allowed to continue to drive was for consideration of his hostage. The most important thing to them was that 9-month-old child. as it should have been. We'll be back.
Get the info. Get the info.
Stay informed. It's a new day with Rip Daniels, the number one talk show in South Mississippi on Jay-Z 94.5.
Fellas, I wonder what you mind if I talk to you a minute. You know, sometimes we have our tendencies, or should I say we forget what a woman needs every now and then. That is, if you want to keep your thing together.
All right, folks. Morning to you. Rip Daniels here. Thank you for joining us. The show is called It's a New Day. There's only one rule. There's no such thing as a right or wrong opinion here, folks. We in Mississippi ought to be thankful that there's a group that's coming that's going to help individuals who are sitting in jail right now because they can't post bail. We ought to be thankful. I'm going to tell you more about that. And then there is, let's see, where is it here? The Gates. You know, very sadly, there are those who feel that everybody's life is hunky-dory. If Bill and Melinda Gates' life has not been hunky-dory, nobody should be. What, $100 billion? You know, money doesn't change everything. I mean, you can't buy happiness. I can tell you that right now. And if by chance you think so, you need to ask yourself, what happened to Bill and Melinda?
Yeah.
Yeah, there's no joking about that. 40-somethings right now are now at least partially vaccinated, according to the CDC. Tell that to those folks there in India. All right, to the phones, 228-896-9455. Mr. Mann, good morning. Thank you for being patient. Good morning, Mr. Mann.
Oh, yes. I just wanted to say that that's straight-up murder. By knowing that baby was in
the car. Straight up murder. I hear you. Well, brother, I can't say that I can argue with you. I really can't. There's certainly some intent one can argue. What bothers me, however, is what do we do about it? There are policies in place regarding the use of force. And policies in place regarding the use of force when there is a hostage. Why there was a passionate disregard for the hostage, a four-month-old little LaMello Parker. This beats me. And what was the urgency? There's a lot more videos that we are becoming privy to, and I hope that the investigator really evaluates this from not a political standpoint, but just from a ethical and law enforcement standpoint. Was it or was it not good police work? I mean, if that is the case, come on, just come out and say so. Move forward. If there has to be some consequences, come out and say so. You know, don't mish words with it. Don't try to decorate it. We, the American, the Mississippi or Gulf Coastian public, we support law enforcement here. Regardless of what any one individual says, we hadn't had that kind of huge doubt, even with Jesse Williams. Even with Jesse Williams, whereby some nine officers were taking the task, one of which is still serving a life sentence. You didn't have that kind of response. And not that it's bad. I mean, people got a right to protest. People got a right to do that. Certainly don't have a right to loot. And with every protest, there's not a looting. Contrary to what you'd hear on Oxy conservative land radio. Let's go to Doc. Doc, good morning.
Good morning. You know, I just don't see how those black officers just out there mocking them folks keep their job. I guess that's why I work for myself, you know. They just don't rise to the magnitude of me. If I'd have been on the police board, just me one, they couldn't have did it.
Well, how would you?
I wouldn't let them do it. No, y'all, you're not shooting in that car. That's a black baby in there. And I'm black.
Yeah.
You know, I said black. I'm trying to change that to Negro and Afro-American or whatever color. Ain't no such thing as black and white.
Yeah.
You know, I told you that needs to go away. But you couldn't have did. I don't see how they go home and face their wife.
Yeah. Let me ask you this. So you think it was out of race? What gives you that? Is it because the baby was African American and the suspect was African American? So you don't think this could have happened to a Caucasian child?
No, they wouldn't have shot him then. You know, I'm looking hard. I'm not a member of the NAACP, but I'm with them all the way. I'm looking hard at you, and I want you to rise to the occasion.
Yeah.
You know, do what you're supposed to do. If you don't do no more than me, put a sign out in your yard. I'm going to put one out there. I'm going to stand with you.
Appreciate that.
You know, I'm good at them signs.
Yeah. Nothing is never the right thing to do, that's for sure. But if you don't know where you're going or any road to take you there,